one's accepted. One's like they want to do their for the okay, let's keep going. So everyone prefers the spectral domain and Fourier domain. So the camera base or tunable laser. And so this is a fact. That's the and I you'll reach the same conclusion that that's the technology of future. Okay. Now I wanted to go then to disadvantages of this to show you what is left there for the research community to address to make this technology even better. Before doing that, why this technology is considered better than time domain? What is the answer to this? The speed is an ingredient. There is something else, which is fundamental. Close. I would say sensitivity. Is this one. This paper, Japanese Journal of Applied Physics, 1999. Can you read the text, please? You'll have the answer. The dynamic range, so the paper does the theory of a spectrometer-based low coherence interferometer. Let's don't say OCT, because by that time Mitsui didn't do OCT. He had an interferometer, and he looked at the sensitivity of this interferometer. And he used the probe mount and the camera-based spectrometer. His conclusion, after two pages of mathematics, was that the dynamic range of the spectrometer implementation in comparison with the time domain is larger than the time domain implementation by a factor, which is the number of saturation charges of the linear image sensor, i.e. the number of spectral windows. How many here are using spectrometers? Hands up. How many pixels do you have on the camera? How many? 1024. How many spectral windows you have for 1024? Half of this, 9%. So you have 512 spectral windows. So you take 500 and multiply it with the time domain and you get the sensitivity in spectral domain. That's the key. That's why this technology is so good. In top of that, you put the other fact, the fact that your FFT is giving you all depth information in one go. That's an extra. But for that reflectivity measurement done at a single depth point, that's why spectral domain, camera or subsource is better than time domain. Due to this, it was, I could tell you a story here, it was 1998, a fantastic Russian scientist, Yuri Mazurenko from St. Petersburg, came to Kent several times, we were speaking on the email, telling me, Adrian, give up time domain. I didn't believe him. Until 2002, Maciej Wojtkowski in Toruń made a spectrometer system and obtained an image of the retina. But it took me 4 years to accept this. Okay? So by the time the demonstration was made, I completely forgotten about this, which Yuri told me all the time. Okay? And there's another lesson here, the fact that by 2004-2006, two big OCT groups published two highly cited papers demonstrated that the subsource and camera based are superior to time domain. But they haven't referenced to this one. So that's the message to take. You do your PhD thesis, you write a book, do the referencing. Don't leave out important pieces of because that will haunt you later. This has to be recognized. This guy realized long time before what is the benefit of using multiple spectral windows and superposing the signals from many parallel spectral windows you put together.
But isn't the point that you have the signal on each of those spectral windows, so you divided up the signal.
You have the channel spectrum, you have 100, you have your number of 200,
so you have
which
all,
are over 500 yeah, spectral windows.
But you have all the signal that you want, but you've spread the noise now over all the other 511 sensors. So the noise is spread out. In time domain, you get all of the noise and your signal onto the same sensor. So that's why you get the improvement, isn't that?
Maybe, but we have to look into the mathematics of this. So E plus, when you do camera, the cameras are exclusively short noise limited because you don't have sufficient power to make the excess photon noise for Gaussian statistics larger than the short noise. So you won't have more noise than the short noise in the camera base. That explanation might have worked with a tunable laser, but we have to look into the mathematics because that comes not from the fact that the noise is more, it's simply the fact that you cooperatively add the spectral information from the 512 windows. I don't have more slides on Mitsui. We have to look into mathematics, but that's a fact. And there are two more papers citing, demonstrating, and plus there is another patent in OCT showing the superiority. Again, no reference to Mitsui. I gave you the reference, you can read it. So, that's one example where OCT has reinvented the wheel. The OCT community has reinvented the wheel in terms of this. Now, let me take you to disadvantages. There are quite a few. And that's the way the commercial systems operate. The first one, zero, number, is the calibration. You need to calibrate the data. The second is you work under fixed focus. You collect all this millimeter axial range with a fixed focus. Not like in confocal microscopy. You love to do confocal microscopy, to put your focus at the depth you wanted. There is one fundamental here, very fundamental. The fact that the sensitivity decays with depth, while the time domain doesn't have that sensitivity. Mirror terms, if you go the other side of the OPD zero, you have again a ghost image. It's called mirror terms. And I will show you that it's the same physics which is responsible for this. And the explanation comes from the Talbot bands. Okay? And there is another one which is very important now, is with the tremendous progress in making this spectral domain and Fourier domain fast. Megahertz sources bumped into this problem now. Because they are so fast, you can get a significant volume less than 1 second, but it takes you long to display the unfast image because you have to cut the volume. Okay? So acquisition is fast now, but the display lags behind. And that's a problem for the technology. Let's take them bit by bit. Calibration. So what do? You have an interferometer, a spectrum interrogator. So the interferometer is the Michelson, then the spectrum interrogator could be either the spectrometer in spectrometer base or the photodetector when you use the tunable laser. I hope you accept that. So for both cases, the spectrum interrogator will do the same. Will practically read the channel spectrum, will read the modulation in the channel spectrum. It's the same. And after that you do a Fourier transformation and you have the A-scan. That's what you do. However, that's the problem. Your spectrometer, you have a diffraction grating, you write the simple mathematics and you say sinus of alpha proportional with these wavelengths. You don't need wavelengths, even if it was proportional wavelengths. That's wrong. What you wanted along the pixels on your camera to have what? To have what? Who's doing the camera? You don't do it properly unless you do this. You wanted to have along the pixels optical frequency or wave number. Your signal is not along the axis of the wave number. It's again along the camera line. And that coordinate is not optical frequency. So because of that, you have to take your data, which is denser here, the blue, and with less modulation, red. And you have to reorganize it to have a channel spectrum which is totally, totally similar to a sinus. And now the sinus has a single frequency. If you do the FT of your distorted signal, which we call it chirp from the technology chirped laser, does everyone understand what is a chirp? Chirp is, if there is an irregularity in your sinus which is not sinus. Okay? So if you do the FT of chirp, you'll get all the components associated to that chirp. So that coding and decoding, which coded the OPD into a single number of peaks in the spectrum, only works if you do the process inverse from a scale, which is linear in optical frequency. So what you do, and everyone does this, so that's your channel spectrum coming from the camera, where there are swept sources. They are not linear in frequency. All the swept sources you buy, they are very non-linear. You have to stay within the range where they are linear, and on top of that, systems do this correction. So if you do the phase over the channel spectrum, so we call this channel spectrum, I told you. So if you do the phase, as you go from one peak to the next, you get this phase versus pixels in the camera, or time for the signal coming from the photodetector. If you do the FFT of this, look what you get. But you have a single mirror. So your coding was perfect. You coded the position into modulation. But what you decode now is totally wrong. Because you get position here, 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 here. So what is your OPD? It's totally wrong. So what you have to do is to linearize the phase. And when you linearize the phase, this becomes a sinus, okay, and that becomes a single peak. And you immediately see another problem here for this technology, which unless you do that, you are unable to put a tag on what is exactly the depth position. Plus, it's not only for medical applications, it's for metrology. With this advent of NKT sources, super continuum and so on, we pretend to do axial resolution at the level of submicron. I'm sure many of you would do this resampling and linearization. You would see it on your LabVIEW program. When you do that, your peak moves tens of microns. So this vessel, which works so well, has a problem. And very few people have seen this problem. So metrologically, you cannot put a tag on your OPD. In time domain is perfect. You can take a micrometer stage, you can put it at sub-sub-micron position, and that's absolute. Here, we rely a lot on going one way to the Fourier domain and coming back. And by doing this method to correct the signal, you may lose something, and you lose calibration. But when you produce an image, it's still okay within 10 microns. Okay? And there is something else. You establish the procedure, but you have to do it on the fly. Each time you collect another spectrum, you have to do it, resample, linearize. So it takes time, even in the process of... Although this is not exactly true if you do non-linear FFT, but that's another story. Another way to get around is for swept sources. You see the OCT interferometer there. That's the digitizer with the photodetector. So what tunable lasers come now is, they come with a clock. So that's the first complication. You need a clock. A clock. Then, another complication is, you wanted Martin's number 200. You do one scan at 1 mega, 200 mega. What is your clock? You need 400 mega. Speed source now at 30 mega. If you have 1,000 pixels, let's go away from Martin's number 1,000, which is possible. 1,000 times 30 mega is 30 gigahertz. To do the clock, you need 60 gigahertz. No, that's what the technology is. No, impossible. We don't have technology for that. So, not only that you provide a clock, but the photodetector has to be faster than the photodetector you put in the OCT. Disadvantage, okay? Another direction is that of simply, so if you go now and buy the fantastic swept source of over 1 mega from OptiRes, coming from Robert Huber's research, is 1.4 megahertz line rate, okay? And it's difficult to make a good clock there. So you will resort to this software method. You look at the phase, you correct it, and you apply it, but it's imperfect unless you do many multiple phase corrections. One, we can discuss that. The other disadvantage, dynamic focus not possible. What is dynamic focus? Does anyone know? The fact that you collect all those depths with a single position of the lens, that means that your focus is only at some depths within the axial range. Your axial range is 2 millimeters, And let's say that you use a high NA, which will give you a depth of focus of 100 microns. All the rest of the B scan is dark, and your image is here. FFT is wrong, your signal is here. Inefficient utilization of resources. You like to move the focus. Time domain allows you to move the focus. Anytime you fix the OPD zero, you move the focus. You do it again, you have time to move the focus. So let's look at the theory of dynamic focus, which is applicable only in time domain. So let's say that you have a cuvette with liquid here. Okay? And at the top of the cuvette with liquid, I fix the length of the object path equal with the length of the reference path. So I'm OPD equals zero on that top of the liquid, between glass and the liquid. I move now the liquid delta. Let's say that I move it 1 millimeter towards the lens. What happens with the focus? No OCT, no interference. What the beam will do if I move the liquid to the left? What the beam will do inside? Due to refraction, look, due to the refraction, we'll do this. We'll go longer. So we'll go inside the liquid, measure from the top of the cuvette to delta N. Delta time N. Move it 1 millimeter. Index of refraction is 1.3. It moved inside 1.3 millimeters. Fine. What is the OCT coherence gate? If you move the liquid inside, what is the coherence gate now? The coherence gate was here. But because now you replaced air with liquid, you replaced air of 1 with liquid of 1.3 to have the same length, that means that your coherence gate moved oppositely in this direction to delta over N. So you see, your confocal gate went this way, the coherence gate is this way. To put them together, you have to do this calculation. So you have to move your reference mirror in the interferometer by delta N square minus 1. So 1.3, 1.69, let's say, minus 1, 0.7 times 1 millimeter, and you put the coherence gate where the focus is. And you can do that because you are allowed to do it in time domain. Schmidt came with a, in 1997, with a solution. Ah, I can do that automatically, but only for a particular case of tissue. So what he did, look here, the band is, broadband SLD is here, photo detector is there, I go to the cuvette, fine, and the reference, I place it on a stage. So this stage moves the lens. So I move it closer or away from the cuvette, but at the same time, modifies the reference path. And if you do the calculation, delta, okay, here, because you go there twice, you'll have a 2 delta, but the focus inside went to n delta times the index of refraction, n square delta. That means that if you do this equality, you see that if your substance satisfies this equality, you have dynamic focus accomplished. And we are lucky here, because tissue is 136 to 140 something. So it's this simple method. If you look into tissue, not in object of art, which may have even, there are materials exceeding 1.7 index of refraction. But for tissue, it works. So we did an improvement to this with this configuration. So why do you think this configuration is any better? Cushing is Michael here. Michael Hughes. He was my PhD when he did that, now he's at Imperial with Cushing. So, SLD going, coming back, balance detector, reference. So what is the difference between this configuration and this configuration? So as you see here, both arms suffer something in the translation. Okay? You do something with both objects, you move the lens in the object arm, and with the reference, you move their lenses and translation stage. While here, there is only one stage. We operate only on the object arm. So we put the stage with the mirror on this one, so we leave the reference path unaltered. So again, that will work as long as the tissue is 1.4. Good. Another technology which is now embraced by the spectral domain is called Galway filtering. So You cannot do dynamic focus with the camera based, you cannot do dynamic focus with the tunable laser. I hope that that is clear. Is that clear? That you have an axial range of 2 millimeters or 1 centimeter, you put the focus here, you did an FFT, whatever this shallow depth and this deep point saw via the confocal microscope profile, that is what is going to modulate your A-scan. Yeah.
So you can only do dynamic focusing in a material where the reflection...
With those, no, you can do it with simply moving the reference, but with those two configurations, Schmidt or Michael Hughes, only if the tissue is 1.4.
Okay, so if you have a sample that's not biological but has large refractive index changes, then you need to know all the refractive index.
If you wanted to be, especially if you go to these high resolution, large boundary sources, you need to know that. But you can still do it in time domain. While in spectral, it's not that you cannot do it. It's practically, we shouldn't speak about it. It's inapplicable. Okay.
How much do you gain by it then? The dynamic focusing?
That's another discussion in terms of how you choose your imaging instrument. If you wanted a transversal resolution, which is micron, you need a lens of high NA. If your lens is high NA, your depth of focus is tens of microns. An FT will give you 5 millimeter axial range. Your 5 millimeter is gonna be bright only in the confocal selection, in the confocal profile. So everyone works now with a long confocal gate. And that's why the spectral domain was so successful for the eye. Exactly because of that. Because the eye length is so long, the NA is so small, it's a lens with a 2 centimeter focal length. So retina is 2 centimeter away. The NA, if you consider the 3 millimeter here, is below 0.1. So with that one, you have a large depth of focus. If our eyes would have been animal eyes of only 5 millimeters, you would have done time domain for human eye.
I've heard my previous supervisor talk about OCM, so optical coherence microscopy. Is that basically the same thing then as dynamic focusing in your case?
Or? Optical coherence microscopy, I think, is optical confocal with a high NA plus the heterodyne gating from the interference.
How is that different from your...
And you can do it with spectral domain and time domain. So if you do it time domain, you will do dynamic focus. If you do spectral domain, you will recur to some solutions around the problem, which is called Gabor filtering. I don't have the mathematics of Gabor, but that refers to a kernel of the integral, the main point of the integral, with a window, which you shift it axially. So this method has a patent from Jean-Nic Roland at Institute of Optics Rochester. So what is that? Very simple. You move the focus, repeat acquisition. Move the focus, repeat acquisition, and stitch the results, the best results from each B scan into a final image. That's done.
I think we should, if we can, take a break at this point because there's some coffee for us back up at the poster session. So we're at the poster room. So let's do that. Thanks to Adrian.